over abuse and exploitation of incumbency.
But you haven't proven that. I've heard you say this before, but without proof.
Good. How can I prove it? I don't have a mandate of audit.
Because I heard you actually say you are probing this.
Yes. And
but if you're probing it, you must come with the evidence.
That is why the Constitution provides independent institutions to do that.
You can file a petition at the...
You are quoting World Bank and IMF. Yeah. They refuse to listen to the minority. Now they have listened to World Bank and IMF and have agreed to a COVID audit only because the money emanated from them. But what they must know is that it's the taxpayers' money which is used to service the money borrowed from them.
You can't file a complaint.
We did.
Are the right institutions to investigate this?
I'm here with you. I'm expressing my disappointment that when we said that subject COVID expenditure to an open, transparent audit for Ghanaians to appreciate what went where, for what purpose, were denied in silence until they said they and IMF and World Bank, because there was some investigation of a sort that they now want to establish it. Now, when you go through that, and that reminds me, you have again Nana Akufo-Addo and his presidency. You know what's happening at the airport, this $150 which has now come to 50 Frontier Health Services, and the excuse is that under COVID, they didn't have to go through procurement process. Is it only Ghana which has COVID? The other countries which is undertaking it, didn't they go through procurement? Are you asking for suspension of our laws? You ousted the Ghanaian procurement laws just to self-serve a business friend. That is wrong. And that is unacceptable.
That's an allegation you made there.
It's not an allegation. I'm saying that.
Who is this business friend?
I'm saying that it did not go through due process. It did not go through legitimate respect.
You're almost suggesting nepotism. Nepotism here. A business friend.
I'm not afraid to use that word. We want to know who owns that business. Why couldn't Noguchi conduct that exercise?
I mean,
why couldn't the Kumasi Center of
the health minister
exercise?
Came before the committee that you were a member of?
Yes.
You asked him these questions?
Yes.
And you still approved his nomination?
Yes. You see, good. I'll come to explain parliamentary nomination for you. You see, you are mixing content issues with minimum legitimate requirements of law. Read Article 94 of the 1992 Constitution well. It says the basis of what makes a person qualify to be member of parliament. It further says the basis of what makes a person qualify to be minister of state. If you have any constitutional breach, share it with me. We probe. And as we probe, we are looking for many of them who may be found wanting to meet the minimum constitutional thresholds. Then you move to criminal threshold, whether or not you have evidence. It's not just a matter of saying that Evans have done this wrong. Do you have material facts to support it? I'll give you an interesting example. I know a foreign embassy who is related to me about a nominee involved in visa racketeering. I've formally written to the embassy. Up till yesterday, they have not responded. But the same embassy, a few years ago, said that, Haruna, I want to share with you MPs who are involved in visa racketeering. I just simply cannot allege. I must go beyond it to establish prima facie evidence as my basis. I don't have it. In many situations, I can take individual by individual cases when we get there. But I'm simply saying that, yes, we fell short of public expectations. We fell short of the expectations of the NDC party following. But we did not necessarily fall short of the requirement of the law.
I want to take a quick break shortly, because but before I do, I need to exhaust this part of the, before we come to the rest of the issues in Parliament, etc. Labour, you were formerly a Labour minister. And I'm interested in this because just 2 weeks ago, we celebrated May Day. There's still a lot of conversations around minimum wage conversations. We are almost in the middle of the year. Is this standard practice? You were there that, you know, agreement hasn't been reached, etc. Forward, nobody...
You know, sometimes governance is a continuum. President Nana Addo Dankwa must appreciate the NDC and President Mahama and many of us for bringing the insidious labor conflict to an end. It had to do with tier two pensions that I basically resolved as Minister for Employment. Now, if you look at public sector wage negotiations, I had set a new standard recognized by the same World Bank. Tomorrow I share a World Bank report on it for you, that conclude minimum wage, conclude public sector-based wage negotiations before budget. So 2014, 2015, 2016, I worked very closely with then Minister Setekpe to achieve that. And I say the World Bank recognizes, because then it allowed the Minister of Finance to plan effectively and to project ahead, particularly of the compensation budget of Ghana, which was worrying as a percentage of revenue and as a percentage of GDP. We managed to resolve many of those issues, including what I call a signature credit given health workers, their first certified, codified conditions of service. I got them signed on to it. So if you see some stability in the labor front, don't take absolute credit as if it's only the doing of President Nanadu Dankwa and his Minister for Labor. The foundations were laid. Now, it struck me as Minister for Employment, when the budget was presented on behalf of the President, there was no text on an adjustment in the compensation allocation. So if you recall, it was one of the immediate issues I brought to fore. True. So it meant that this government anticipates that they don't want to increase wages for this.
Is that a standard pattern? You budget for then you go and negotiate.
You know, they are very interesting. You went to the economist, blame COVID, profit from COVID. Now you understand why I made that statement. Where the economy is in difficulty, blame COVID. Where the economy has inflicted hardships, tax the people for purpose of rebounding the economy. It doesn't work that way. So it means that when you hear President Nanadu Dankwa, and I heard you on Joy News dealing with it, says that there is a freeze of increases for persons in the executive. How many are people in the executive? Is it not the same Nana Akufo-Addo who ran the largest size of government in Ghana's fourth Republican history?
But that would definitely make a difference.
No.
It won't?
No. In 2020, he lived with COVID and could have downsized government. He didn't do it until this time. That's what I call.
But keeping them honest, your government also adopted similar measures in hard times. And John Mahama took advance of pay cuts that all government appointees had to take. Didn't you do so?
I say in governing a country, go beyond symbolic pretensions. Cut expenditure.
Was it symbolic pretensions when John Mahama did it too?
No, and I'm saying that what meaning does that make? You see, you must get a labor economist to give you the numbers. That's woefully insignificant.
So what do you expect, Gordon?
And I say that's woefully insignificant. They are expecting labor to make some sacrifices. Initially, when he started this interview, he wanted to know whether I have sympathy. I'm sympathetic on that.
Okay.
That can labor, appreciating the consequence of COVID, give in somehow, but the same labor is coming under increases in utility prices, water and electricity. So they would use that to justify that you necessarily must give them an increment. But probably what government can do in a post-COVID environment is to negotiate towards what we did, COLA, cost of living allowance. Whether labor will accept it, I'm unable to predict it. But it is wrong for government to assume. Every other year, as I was Minister for Labor, you peg it at naturally at inflation rate. So labor will be expecting 10, 11, 12% increases. I wish that I could recognize somebody publicly. I don't know if he wants me to do that.
Who?
The president of the Ghana Employers Association.
Why are you recognizing him?
There are people in the choir who help in the development and growth of this country and economy on the quiet. Terry Dankwa, I believe, at the time. And then even minimum wage. You know, even Ghanaians, we consume minimum wage with public sector wage. Minimum wage affects just the private sector, not the public sector. For public sector, you must have base pay negotiation. But minimum wage is to allow private sector entities to peg incomes and earnings not below a certain expectation. Ghana is not there. The world is now debating decent wages. You don't even have the minimum wage. I'm talking of a decent.
Do you expect an increase across the board in the negotiation that the tripartite committee is, knowing what you know?
I don't know what is going on at the tripartite. But what I do know is that the leadership of labor can be very reasonable. I've recently read, and today as I walk into my office in parliament, I got a communication from CLOSAC, who are raising questions as to who should be the supervising minister for pensions, whether it should be the minister of finance or it should be the minister for labor. For all intents and purposes, I had the privilege and honor under President Mahama to supervise pensions.
As so
the National
minister.
Pension Regulatory Authority was under my watch as minister for labor, naturally because of the huge burdens that came with tier two pension, and appreciating how much some 3.2 billion, which was in a temporary pension fund account with the Bank of Ghana, ought to have been utilized and diverted. So even as we are discussing government debt, this Minister for Finance is silent, dead silent, on how much he owes in respect of pensions. Mm. Probe it. You are a journalist. Be interested in it. So when you say your economy is well, it's like they come into parliament and say, Ajapa. It simply means you are taking your wife gold ring to go and sell. And you say you are a very good husband. They should hail you as a husband.
I want to take a quick break. When I return, we will look at the special prosecutor nomination. We'll look at parliament, his domain. We'll talk about the national security conversation that has engulfed this country. We'll get his thoughts on the party itself that he belongs to. You want to stay with us because I know you'll be interested in what he says. I mean, he was accused a lot. Some say he was he assaulted his conscience. I wonder how he felt in the midst of all that accusations, because he's a human being. I know he has a thick skin. Did it get to him at all?